Our new series. Does everyone have a handout? Anyone need a handout? A little handout. Anyone need it? Okay, good. All right. I know you will see the handout that I have tonight is much different than the handouts we've been doing. As we went through our cult series, man, I had a ton of notes for that, didn't I? So you would not believe. Oh, anyway, that was a time-consuming effort just even doing that. So that's one of the things I've been looking forward to with this series is I can scale back on the notes side a little bit and really just kind of present some things. And I'm going to have some notes on the screen here in a few minutes. You're welcome to write those down if you want to and to follow along. Maybe you hear something else. That's kind of why I've done the sheet this way. I want you to be able to write down if there's something that you hear, something that catches your attention, because I don't know about you, sometimes when I'm going through a study like this where we begin looking at some of the things that we're going to look at, especially as we get into these stories, I may make a point and have a point up here, but you may hear something that you've never heard before, never seen before, and that's something you want to write down and take a little note of. And that's kind of how my mind works as I study and prepare for these things. I'm sitting here going through and I'm doing all my studies, and suddenly I'll be reading some commentator and they point out something that I had never seen before. And so that sometimes works its way into the message and sometimes it doesn't. But this will give you a little freedom to write the things that impact you. And if you just want to follow the outline on the screen, that's perfectly fine too. So this evening, I want you to imagine with me for a moment that we in this room live in a remote region of the world, okay? We live in some far-out region where we have never heard any of Jesus' parables. Now, I know the people in this room. We've heard, many of us have heard the parables of Jesus many times. But imagine you live somewhere, you've never heard any of his parables. We're there in our little village, and one day we discover an ancient parchment. And we find this parchment in an underground cave that contains what others who live closer to civilization call the parable of the sower. All right? Now, we in our little village, we don't even know what to call this parchment. We don't know what to make of this parchment. We don't even, we don't know what to do with it. But our curiosity has been piqued. We found this document. We don't know what it says or what it means. And so we get our best language scholars to study this very strange text on this parchment until they can finally read it to us. And for the first time ever, we hear these words. A sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. And that's it. That's where the parchment ends. That's all we have, is that little story. What would we think about it in that moment? What would we think? Some of us might think that it's just a story, right? It's a short one and maybe even kind of a boring story. Some might think that maybe this parchment is some kind of ancient instruction manual on gardening. Because, after all, the text talks about how a farmer goes out and scatters seed on four different types of surfaces, with only one surface actually producing any kind of real grain. But we know in our little community that we would never use the technique that is said in this parchment, because clearly any right-minded person would never sow seed on rocky or thorny surfaces. So you see the problem. That is the problem we face as modern New Testament believers. Here's what happens. We are so familiar with the parables, just like this one, the parable of the sower. And we're so familiar with their interpretation that we often fail to realize that these words of Jesus by themselves hold little to no meaning at all, right? The words themselves of the parable of the sower really don't have much meaning. They don't utilize religious language. They don't spell out any great theological concepts. And that's why it was necessary for Jesus' disciples to gather around him and ask one simple but important question. They come up to Jesus and they basically say, Jesus, what in the world are you talking about? I mean, he's been teaching and suddenly he breaks out this parable of the sower and they're like, what? What is this, Jesus? What are you talking about? Jesus, why don't you just speak simply and straightforward? Jesus, why are you teaching in parables? And that question is going to be answered in our text tonight. If you've got a Bible, we'll be in Matthew chapter 13, as you see on your sheet. We'll be in Matthew 13. And in this series about the parables, about the master's stories, we're going to look at many of the master stories. I'm going to tell you, we are not going to look at every single parable that is called a parable. In fact, our series is going to focus on the parables that are story-driven, okay? Now, that's actually a lot of parables, but we're going to focus on the stories of the master, and we're going to try to gather some of the spiritual truths that God has in those parables for us. But before we get to them, we need to see the master's purpose for the parables. And that's what I want to focus on tonight. Tonight is to lay the groundwork as we go into the parables. So let's begin and let's go ahead and read our text in Matthew chapter 13, verses 10 through 17. It says, and the disciples came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? And he answered and said to them, because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore, I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. And in them the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive. For the hearts of this people have grown dull, their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For assuredly I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. All right, so we're going to walk through these verses tonight, and I want you to see a few things, and you'll see on your notes, I've listed four questions that we want to try to answer tonight in preparation for our series in the parables and looking at the parables. And so these questions we need to address at the outset are these. The first one is this. What is a parable? Now, listen, over the years, I have heard many different definitions of a parable. And so before we can really understand what the parables mean, we need to understand what a parable actually is. And I've heard all kinds of definitions, and many of them are good definitions. But I think this one that I'm going to put on the screen, this one is my favorite, I believe, of the definitions of a parable, okay? A parable is a practical story that illustrates spiritual truth. It's a practical story that illustrates spiritual truth. There are all kinds of different parables found in the Gospels. Some of them are famous parables. Listen, we know some of the famous parables. We know the parable of the prodigal son, right? That's one of the most famous ones. We know the parable of the good Samaritan. We know the parable of the lost sheep. We're familiar with some of these parables. They're very well known and preached on a lot. But there are other parables that are lesser known, like maybe the parable of the tenants or the parable of the two sons. And so some are well known, some are not. But no matter how well we know these parables, they are all stories that are meant to illustrate different spiritual truths. Many of the parables will progressively develop different themes from parable to parable. In fact, as we go through this series, we're gonna go through them by their theme. So we're gonna begin next week with the kingdom parables, the parables that really dive into the kingdom of God and progressively reveal more and more truth about the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. And so we're gonna divide them up by their theme and look at those and systematically go through those to understand them. And so there are all kinds of parables found in the Bible, some popular, some not, but they all illustrate important spiritual truths. The second question we need to address is this. How are we supposed to interpret the parables? I mean, think about it. Here come the disciples, and they themselves say, Jesus, why are you teaching this? Why are you doing these parables? They don't make sense. This question is important because different parables have been interpreted and sometimes misinterpreted in different ways throughout the history of the church. And so in order for us, I believe it's important that as we take and we study the Word of God, especially when it comes to the parables, there are, I believe, three principles we always need to keep in mind as we try to interpret the parables, okay? So if we're going to understand what... Yes. If we're going to understand what a parable means, then the first thing we need to do is we need to listen to the parable from the hearer's perspective. Understand, the parable was not written to us in our modern day setting. It was spoken to a specific group of people at a specific time. So we need to put ourselves in their shoes and listen to it from their perspective. And so as Jesus taught with these parables, he very often uses pictures and stories that were much more familiar to the first century Jews than they are to us here in modern day America. And so we need to ask ourselves questions like this as we're talking about listening from their perspective. Here's some questions we can ask. What would they hear as they listen to the story? What would they be hearing as they hear it? What would stick out to them in the story? For instance, when you get to the parable of the Good Samaritan, what is it that sticks out to them in the parable of the Good Samaritan? That it's the fact that a Samaritan, that sticks out that Jesus is even talking about a Samaritan, much less that he makes the Samaritan the good guy, all right? Then we have to look at how would they respond at different points in the story. So again, let's go back to the parable of the Good Samaritan. When they're hearing that story and they get to the priest passing by, the injured guy, and we get to the Levite passing by, and we finally get to the Good Samaritan stopping and helping him, how would they respond at those different points in the story? Would they have been shaking their heads yes that when the priest walked by? Some of them, yeah. You might have had some like, yeah, maybe. Would they have been shaking their heads, yes or no, like curious when they heard about the Levite? And then when he gets to the Samaritan, can you imagine the shock and awe on their face? That's the point. How would they respond, and what kind of emotions would rise up when they heard certain words like Samaritan? All right, that's just an example. So those are the things we want to do. We want to listen from the hearer's perspective. And this is something you can do in your own personal study. If you want to pull aside and start looking at the parables, you can certainly do that. And by the way, this is a good principle just in general for Bible interpretation. Is remember, every one of these books that we're reading were written to a specific audience. Read it from their perspective and think about it from that viewpoint, all right? So listen from the hearer's perspective. Number two, we need to look for the main point. Look for the main point of the story. Every parable has at least one main point. Some of them may have two or three main points, but every one of them will have at least one main point. So as we read the parables, we should always be trying to identify the primary truth being conveyed. Now listen, I've seen some people who want to take the parables and they want to twist them, and they look for every little hidden meaning they can find. And suddenly the parable goes from being the parable about the Good Samaritan to the parable about something we've never heard of. Because they're looking for all these other little hidden truths. And the fact is, how about let's look at the main point that's staring us in the face? That's why he told the story, all right? So look for the main point. Sometimes Jesus will reveal the main point himself, and sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes we're left to have the Holy Spirit reveal it to us. Thirdly, how are we supposed to interpret the parables? We need to let the truth change our perceptions. Let the truth change your perception. Once we understand what the main point is, once we understand what the points of a parable are, we then have a decision to make of whether we're going to allow that truth to change our perception. After all, the whole point of parables is to challenge the way people think about something and to challenge them by using a story. That's exactly what Jesus is doing in Matthew chapter 13. Understand the context of what takes place here in Matthew 13. The people have all been coming for a while now. The people have one viewpoint on what they believe the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven is. They think they know what the kingdom of heaven, what the kingdom of God should look like. And they have their own beliefs about what they believe it will be and how it will come and who will bring it. And Jesus decides in this chapter, he begins to use these parables to teach something different than what they believed to be true. So, for the people, as they hear these stories, will they allow the parable, will they allow the story to change their perception, to change what they had preconceived to be right, and will they allow the truth of the story to change what they believe? Or will they ignore it and keep blindly pushing forward with their incorrect belief? That brings us to the next and probably the most important question for us this evening, and that is question three. What is the purpose of the parables? What is the purpose? Why do we really have these parables? Why doesn't Jesus go ahead and say whatever it is he wants to say, right? I mean, you ever have that person who loves to tell you the long, rambling story, and you just want to look at him and say, will you just get to the point? Yeah, how many of you say, I am that person? No, I'm kidding. I was at Fletty last night, and this guy, man, God bless him. He comes in, bless his heart, yes, he just comes in, and he's rambling on about some new Mexican restaurant, and he just kept going over and over and over and over. I'm like, yeah, 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 can you please be quiet now, please? It was something. Yeah, you just wanted to get to the point, you know, and that's kind of how it is. So that's kind of the question we have. Well, Jesus, why are you telling these stories? Why not just tell us what you really want to say? That's exactly what the disciples are asking in verse 10. When they say, Jesus, why do you speak to them in parables? It's an important question. And Jesus is going to answer their question in verses 11 through 17. And you're going to see that parables, according to him, parables have two primary purposes. Now, again, let me put this in context. Let's remember, up until this point, Jesus has told a few parables, but the reality is almost all of Jesus' teaching has been very straightforward, right? It has been straight. Think about Matthew chapter 5. What do we find in Matthew 5? Anyone? What do we call What's that? The Beatitudes. And what is that a part of? Sermon on the Mount. All right, we got this long Sermon on the Mount, right? And in that Sermon on the Mount, Jesus isn't really telling a bunch of stories. He's just laying out fact after fact after fact after fact, right? He's telling, this is how it is, this is how it is. And so crowds have been growing, people have been listening, people have been watching his miracles, they've been listening to his stories, listening to his teaching, but nothing has really changed. And so now, here he is, he's got this huge crowd that has come around him. He gets on the boat to begin teaching, and instead of just coming out and teaching like he has been, he starts teaching the parable of the sower. And his disciples step back and say, Jesus, why are you doing this? Why are you teaching them in a parable? Why are you teaching them in this story? Why don't you just tell them what you want to say? And this is what he says. He gives them two reasons why he's teaching in parables now. And the first reason is this. Parables conceal the truth. Parables conceal the truth. Again, if you go back one chapter to Matthew chapter 12, verse 46, one of the key words that we find there is the word outside. We're told that Jesus' family was standing outside. Now, that was in a very realistic sense. They were standing outside, but it's also in a very figurative sense. The fact is, Jesus' family didn't believe yet in that moment. In verse 11 of chapter 13, Jesus tells his closest disciples, these men who are on his inner circle, if you will, these men who are considered to be on the inside, that the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven have been given, or they have been revealed to them. But to them, that is, as he points, and he points to the crowds and the Jewish religious leaders, the crowds and religious leaders, or as Mark's account calls them, listen, the parallel account in Mark, guess what Mark calls them? Those outside. All right? And so to those who are outside, to them, it has not been given. Look with me again at verses 12 through 15 here in Matthew 13. Notice what he says. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore, I speak to them in parables, because seeing, they do not see, and hearing, they do not hear, nor do they understand. And in them the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not. Now I'm going to pause there just for a moment. If you've got your Bible open, you're reading that. When you see that phrase, shall not, that is a double negative, okay, in the Greek. It's a double negative. Remember, we've talked about this. A double negative is not like in us. A double negative does not make a positive, right, or whatever it is. Yeah. We don't do double negatives in the English language. In the Greek, they do it. Why? Because it adds emphasis. It is, in essence, Jesus saying, and this verse is saying, hearing you will hear and shall not, definitely shall not, you will not, no matter what, understand. He's adding emphasis. You'll hear it and you will not. There's no way you will understand. And seeing you will see and not perceive. For the hearts of this people have grown dull. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them. Now that's quite a statement, isn't it? To say that the parables are given for the specific purpose of concealing the truth. Doesn't sound like Jesus, does it? Doesn't sound like what some of us know. For some of us, that kind of statement shocks us. What is the Lord really saying here in these verses? Is he really saying that he's teaching in parables to hide the truth, to conceal the mystery of the kingdom, in order to actually prevent outsiders from coming in and finding spiritual healing? Is that what Jesus is saying? because that seems to be at odds with so much of his teaching found elsewhere, where he teaches that he came to bring salvation and forgiveness, not to some, but to all who repent of their sins, right? So how do we reconcile these two conflicting thoughts? Does that mean that these parables, these nice little stories that we read to our kids, that these little stories are actually a means of predetermined judgment by God? Are they a means of punishment to those who persistently refuse to believe? I'm going to shock you with my answer. Yes. Yes, they are. That's exactly what he is saying here. In these verses, we are presented with the same tension we find throughout the scripture, the tension that exists between God's divine sovereignty and man's responsibility to either accept or reject. Both things are true. It really doesn't, and listen, I'm not coming at you from a Calvinist or Arminian theology here. It does not matter what theological background you come from, whether you want to talk about election and preordained and all that. That's not really where we're getting into this. Because no matter what theological background you come from, when you read this passage, we all have to admit that it's very clear that the disciples are freely and graciously what? They are given the mysteries of the kingdom. That's what it says. To you it has been given. That is God's divine sovereignty. While others are not given it, that is also his sovereignty. But in the middle section that we read in verses 13 through 17, that includes that quote of Isaiah chapter 6, and especially in Christ's upcoming interpretation of the parable of the sower. He's told the parable of the sower already, and in verses 18 through 23, he's going to give the interpretation. And so when you take what he quotes from Isaiah and you combine it with his interpretation of the parable of the sower, the emphasis is shifted from God's sovereignty in giving and not giving to man's responsibility or man's culpability in the matter. Let me see if I can phrase it this way. If the saving message of God has been freely offered to all who come into contact with Christ, and this is as he's teaching to them, if the saving message has been freely offered to all who've come in contact with him, and if the gospel has been scattered like seed as Jesus traveled throughout the region of Galilee as he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom, then the parable of the sower is the perfect explanation of why only a few people respond to the gospel. It's the perfect explanation of why only a few enter his kingdom and so many do not. Neither the parable nor its explanation by Jesus tell us why people respond the way they do. But the parable, as Jesus explains it, does identify the source of the problem. And the problem isn't God. The problem is with man. The problem is with the soil, and whether the soil will receive the seed or not. That's the problem. And so the chilling truth of verses 13 through 15 is that just like those in Isaiah's day who repeatedly rebelled against their Creator and Redeemer, those in Jesus' day who have seen Jesus, as he says here, they have heard his message, as he says here, and yet they have continued to reject him, they are punished by only seeing and hearing enough to find God's revelation in these parables to be nothing more than an unsolvable riddle. In other words, he's been teaching. He's been showing them. He's been telling them the truth. They've seen his miracles. They've heard his teaching, and they've rejected it. They still don't believe. And so now these parables are the moment where they're not going to understand the parables. Instead, these parables are nothing more than a riddle to them. They make no sense. So for those who persist in disbelief and disobedience, God's word in Isaiah's prophecies and Christ's parables, they only increase their blindness and deafness. Instead of being windows which cause unbelievers to see the light of salvation, they become closed doors that seal the entrance into God's kingdom. I read a comparison. It was, if you've been, we have some stained glass back here. But if you've ever been to some churches that have like the beautiful stained glass, listen, if you're on the outside, sometimes that stained glass, you can't really tell what it is, right? You can't see what the stained glass actually shows until you go where? Inside. It's concealed to those who are outside, but it is perfectly revealed to those who are inside. That's what he's saying about the parables. At this point, the parables are relaying a truth, but it's only going to show the truth to those who are on the inside. So part of the master's purpose is to conceal from those who reject him and his message and those who are on the outside. God is giving them exactly what they seek. As Paul said in Romans, he has turned them over to a reprobate mind. That's what he's done. All right, there is a second purpose for the master's stories. So if one purpose is to conceal the truth, what's the second purpose? Reveal the truth. So the parables are for the very purpose of concealing and revealing the truth. For those who are on the inside, that is, those who have been saved by grace through faith, the parables are meant to reveal spiritual truth. Notice what Jesus says to his disciples in verses 16 and 17. He says, "Blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For assuredly I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desired to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it." Listen, for those who are on the inside, those who have accepted the truth of the gospel, the parables that once hid truth now reveal truth. Parables remove the veil from what Jesus calls the mysteries of the kingdom. And I love that word mystery. Some of your translations may translate it as the word secrets. That is another word it can be translated as. Think about it. Jesus says, for those who have accepted him, these parables reveal the secrets of the kingdom that those on the outside cannot see. How many of you like when someone comes up to you and says, "Hey, can I share a secret with you?" Oh, I see someone shaking their head. No. when someone shares a secret to you, it means a lot, right? What does that tell you? It tells you you've got a close relationship with them. It tells you that they've got something important that they feel they can trust you with. There is a sense of care there, a sense of trust and belonging, and they trust you to keep it. So most of the time, when someone does share a secret, it's special to you, unless it's your daughter telling you to keep a secret from everyone in the church and your family that she is coming for a weekend. That is not a special secret. That's an annoying secret. I know she'll eventually listen to this recording, so I love you, sweetheart. Okay. Listen, as a special gift, Jesus shares certain secrets with his closest followers. These 12 men, they've been following him around for some time now. And he says, "Hey, I've got some secrets I want to share with you. And so I've given these secrets to you because you mean something to me. You're important to me. You're a part of my followers." And the secrets that he calls the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven are what he shares. And it's only to these special followers that he is giving the secret. He says, "It has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom." We're not told the exact nature of the secret, but from what these disciples have already seen and heard, we can safely assume that they concern the future rule of God as revealed in the person, the work, and the words of Jesus Christ. Look at what Jesus said a little bit later in chapter 13. Look down at verses 34 and 35. Verse 34, he says, "All these things Jesus spoke to the multitude in parables, and without a parable, he did not speak to them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables, I will utter things," what? "Kept secret from the foundation of the world." Paul goes on to shed even more light about these mysteries, these secrets in his letters. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 19, that he has been commissioned to boldly make known what? The mystery of the gospel. Listen, in other words, what once was hidden from the very foundation of the world is slowly coming to light through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus is telling his followers, listen, you're seeing the light come. You're seeing the secret be revealed that no one else around can see. But you see it. Everything that's been hidden is being revealed to you now, and I'm giving that to you. I'm showing it to you. It's only in Jesus that the mystery comes to light. It's not a riddle anymore to those who are on the inside. The secret is out. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 7 through 10. Ephesians 1, 7 through 10 says this: "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will." You hear that? He's made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. Why? That in the dispensation of the fullness of the times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. Listen, what once was hidden to the world and still remains hidden to the crowd in front of Jesus, and still remains hidden to the Jewish religious leaders, and still remains hidden to all those who refuse to accept Jesus as Lord. Listen, to all of what once was hidden to all of them has now been revealed by God to this group of people that includes a former tax collector, that includes some simple fishermen, that includes anyone who is humble enough to heed the call of Christ. Parables conceal, but they also reveal. And so that's what they are there for. So we'll see that as we go through. Now, what does all of this mean for us? What does this mean for us? We get it. They conceal and they reveal. What do we do with that information? How does that help us at all? Well, I want to give you three thoughts here about what it means for us as people today. Number one is this: unbelievers should respond to the warning of the parables. Unbelievers should respond to the warning of the parables. Over the coming weeks as we go through these parables, listen, if a person fails to see the truth that's being taught in them, or they fail to hear the truth that's being taught, recognize the warning. Don't let the parables be a means of God's punishment. Instead, allow the parables and God's truth to penetrate your heart. Many of the parables end with words of warning like this: "In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Listen, that's a warning. I don't have to understand it, but there's a warning there. And so, as an unbeliever, you have a choice. I can either listen to the warning or I can ignore it. It's kind of like if you set your alarm clock in the morning. I know some of us, we love our alarm clocks. We have a special love-hate relationship with them. But it's like that alarm clock that beeps loudly in the morning to wake us from our sleep, right? We can choose to ignore the alarm clock, or we can realize the alarm clock has an important message for us, which is, it's time to get up. It's time to get going. It's time to move. It's time to go. Now, if you're my son, you ignore that for about an hour. But it's a message that says it's time to get up. Listen, when we hear the parables, if we're struggling to understand it, we need to take the warning and get it. We must choose whether we're going to respond or not. The message of the kingdom demands a response. So for those who have never trusted in Christ, the parables won't make sense, and that should be a warning to us. Take that as a warning that something is wrong and you need to seek out Christ now. Secondly, what about for us as believers? Believers should respond with gratitude for God's grace. We should respond with gratitude for God's grace. Listen, we need to be grateful for the gift that is mentioned in verses 11 and 12. The very gift of being able to see and hear and believe. We should be grateful that while we once were deaf to the gospel, now we hear. As the hymnist said, what did he say? I once was blind, but what? Now I see. Listen, we need to be grateful for the gift God has given us. He's given us the gift of revelation. Are you grateful for the grace God has shown you and the gift he's given? Listen, we could spend a lifetime trying to answer a question that Scripture never fully answers. And the question is this: why doesn't God just save everyone? Anyone ever asked that question? Why doesn't God just save everyone? Why has this gift of salvation been given to me, but not to blank? And you fill in the blank. Listen, we could spend hours on that question, but instead of trying to figure that out, what we need to do is take a step back in awe and wonder and gratitude in our hearts that God chose to give us salvation, and he chose to give us spiritual understanding. Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3, he said, we all once were by nature children of wrath. Let me ask you a question. What kind of gift does a child of wrath deserve to get? A spanking. Yeah, it's not a good gift, right? A child of wrath doesn't deserve a great, wonderful gift. And that's what we are. Do they even deserve to get a gift? Think about this. Which one of us here tonight truly deserves to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven? Do any of us deserve it? Who in this room deserves to open the gift of the gospel? None of us deserves it. And yet Romans 5:8 says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And because of this fact, we can hear the parables, we can understand the parables, and that should lead us to a place of gratitude. It should lead us to a place where we thank God for his loving grace in our lives, that he gave us the truth. The parables should lead us to praise. After Thomas saw the resurrected Christ's wounds and after he heard his voice, Jesus looked at Thomas and said, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Do you feel blessed tonight? Can you say to Jesus with awe and gratitude, my Lord and my God? So many great heroes of the faith in the Old Testament, they longed to know Jesus Christ the way we do today. They longed to hear his words read and explained each week. They longed to sense his presence and power through the Holy Spirit like we have today. Listen, we have been truly blessed with a great privilege. That's what we see from the parables. Let me give you one other thought. And that is this: believers should share the secret. Believers should share the secret. Why have we been given this gift? We have been given, we have been blessed to bless. We have been given to give. Listen, we have been given God's grace as a gift as a gift to be given to others. After Jesus finished teaching this set of parables in Matthew 13, we come down to verse 51. And Jesus asked a question. Look at verse 51 with me. Jesus said to them, "Have you understood all these things?" He's just finished all these parables. "Have you understood all these things?" And they said to him, "Yes, Lord." Jesus is saying to them, "Hey, do you understand everything I've just said?" And they, in essence, respond, "Well, yeah, Jesus, somehow we do. We're not sure how we understand it, but we understand it. We see, we hear, we understand." And then notice what Jesus says next. Verse 52, "Then he said to them, 'Therefore, every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder.'" In other words, everyone who has been taught concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure, that is, who brings out the gospel of the kingdom, who brings out his treasure, things new and old. In other words, Jesus isn't just saying, "Have you been given and have you received?" He's now saying, "Are you giving? You've given, you've received, but are you now giving? If you've been given understanding, if you grasp the secrets of the kingdom, if you have become a scribe," as he says here, "trained in the truths of the kingdom, you know the secrets of the kingdom, you know the mysteries of the kingdom, then you must share your treasures with others." You got to bring the treasures out and share them. And he's using this picture, again, this picture of someone who invites people to come to the house, and they bring the old and the new out, and they want to show them everything. And that's what he's saying. Listen, you know what the old says, and now you know what the new is. You need to bring the old and the new and share it, just like you would if someone came in your house. Luke chapter 12, verse 48 says, "For everyone to whom much is given, from him much will be required." Listen, as believers, we have been given much. We have been given the gospel, and it is required of us to freely give the good news to others. In Acts chapter 7, Stephen, just before he was stoned to death, spoke from the old revelation about the new revelation of Jesus Christ. He spoke about the good news, the new news, that the temple had been replaced by Jesus Christ, that our sins are forgiven through faith in him. And just like Stephen and the 12 apostles who were listening to Jesus, we have been given the gift of salvation so we can give it to others. You see, we've been given a secret, but the secret was never meant to stay a secret. The secret we have been given isn't a secret to keep. It's a secret to share. It's not up to us to make them understand the secret. It's up to us to share the secret. Let God do the revealing. Okay? That's where we finish tonight. Next week, we're going to pick up the kingdom parables, and we're going to start with none other parable, the parable of the sower. All right? So we'll dive into that next week and begin our first story by the master. All right, thanks for coming, y'all.